Welcome to Jam Yaps Media, or Jam for short, where I have passionate conversations about the things that excite me. Earlier this year, I got to speak with Hunter Bergen of AFI ahead of their tour around Australia coming up this month. Let's stop messing about though and get to my interview with Hunter.
Throughout the years, AFI has changed their sound rather significantly. Were there any specific points along the way that influenced those changes?
I mean, each time we set out to write a new record, we are trying to do something new. So, and we're coming from different places, in our personal lives and musically, different things that are influencing us. We never want to write the same record that we've written in the past. So we're always trying to push forward and do something new.
And the latest record sort of recaptures the aggressive sound. Was that something you deliberately set out for?
No, I mean, it's directed a sort of a snapshot of how we're feeling and what we want to express at that point in time. We never really set out to write anything specific, but if, a record seems darker, it's because we were in a dark place, or if it's more aggressive, then we were kind of feeling some aggression. So it's really just sort of a true expression of where we are at that point in time.
And do you know what influenced the aggressiveness this time around?
I mean, I can't speak for anyone else in the band, but I mean, everybody's feeling different sort of frustrations in life, whether they're, have to do with personal relationships or social issues or politics. And the songs are really a combination of us coming together to create something. So sometimes I'm just feeding off of the vibe or the mood that's being set by the other band members, and if it's aggressive, I'll use that to channel whatever I'm feeling aggressive about.
And I believe you wrote close to 60 songs for this record. Was it difficult cutting it down to 14?
We've tried to be sort of economical enough for the last couple of records and not record more songs than we need. We try to work the song list down as we get closer to recording, and then really try to record just what we need. And on this record, I believe we recorded one too many songs. How many are on this record? Did you say 14?
Yep.
Yeah, I think we recorded 15 songs, and our goal was to get it down to like 12. And we couldn't cut that many songs. There was just everybody was, each person sort of weighing in was championing one song or another, and we got to where like there was one that we agreed that we could cut, but we just couldn't get it down lower than that. So it's really difficult because at the point at which we record the songs, we're already really into the songs that we actually record. So to go all the way through that process with the song and then to end up having to cut it,
Will that song now be used for live shows, or will it just disappear?
I'm not sure what we're going to do with that song. It's always a strange thing. Sometimes the songs that don't make the final cut, it's just a matter of sequencing, or for whatever reason. Sometimes they're just as good as the other songs, but then they get released later in some other form with almost bigger fanfare than the album, or maybe than they deserved in the first place. So I'm not sure if we're going to end up doing something with it, or maybe it'll be something we can use for the next record. We haven't really talked about it.
And in the lead up to the announcement of the record, there was a bit of mystery with you blacking out all of social media. Do you think that's something you have to do in this day and age to capture people's attention?
I mean, it's tough. There's so much information bombarding people on a daily basis. that it is tough to make a real impression on people. I mean, myself included. You know, I can't tell you how many times my phone is, you know, telling me about new things or sports scores or just different things. And it's like, I don't know, it, to some degree, like the vast amount of information that's hitting me ever, or anyone on a daily basis just makes each little piece of it less significant. So, yeah, I mean, it does take stuff like that to really get people's attention.
In the lead up to the record, you posted a few teaser clips and there was speculation that there was clues in those clips. Were there any clues that people didn't find?
Well, I mean, we always try to add different little hidden things. And I'm not sure. I mean, I haven't read, you know, too extensively online what people sort of discovered or didn't discover, so I'm not going to be able to really tell you what people didn't find. But I feel like we're always, there's always a little something that people don't quite discover, and that's kind of the magic to it.
And you're coming down to Australia in September for the first headline show in over 10 years. How are you feeling ahead of that?
I am so excited. I love playing in Australia. And it's been so long since we've been there. I mean, it always seems like forever, but yeah, I mean, the last couple times we've just played festivals. So it's going to be really cool to play headlining shows again.
And is it difficult to get motivated for long tours like this after decades together?
I mean, I don't know. Like, we spent so long writing each record and recording that when we actually get to the point where we can play shows and get out there on the road, it doesn't even matter how long the tours are. It's just so much fun to, like, do that part of this whole process. So, you know, I've been waiting for years for this.
And your live show is always something special. In particular, last time you were here, I remember Davey walking out on top of the crowd's hands. Are moments like that planned and discussed beforehand?
No. I mean, that's, he does a lot of things that surprise me, but, you know, like climbing on different things and certainly going out in the crowd. There were a couple shows that we played in Los Angeles a few months ago where he went out into the crowd and then just kept going and climbed up onto a sort of wall that was in the middle of the venue. I don't think he even really knows what he's going to do. I think it's just sort of a spontaneous thing.
And do you just have to sort of go with it?
Yeah, I mean, there was during that particular moment, there was a moment where he sort of went into the crowd, and it was, musically, it was a moment that he cues us for timing, and we couldn't see him, and so it was like, we had to all really tune into each other to see exactly how this was going to work, and it might have not worked, but it did. I mean, there was just as much a chance that it could have completely fallen apart, but it did work out. So, yeah, but I mean, that's part of the fun, you know. But I really like the fact that every audience is going to be different, and in turn, we're going to, you know, play off of the energy of the room and sort of just let whatever happens happen.
And following on from that, what can fans expect from the upcoming Australian shows, and in particular the show in Sydney?
Well, we've been, so far this year, we've been trying to pull a lot of songs from our catalog that we haven't played before, or maybe we haven't played in a long time, and just trying to mix it up every night, a different set. So the best thing I can say is to not assume it's going to be anything. Expect the unexpected. How's that?
Perfect. Thank you very much for your time and good luck with the tour.
Thank you.
If you enjoyed my conversation with Hunter, please like the video, subscribe, and head on over to jamieappsmedia.com so that I can continue to bring you more interviews and reviews like this in the future. Thanks.